Now in the third piece of the integumentary lecture, we've already talked about the epidermis. We talked about the layers of the epidermis and then the cells of the epidermis. And now we're talking about the other two layers, starting with the dermis. The dermis is the middle layer. And the dermis, I hope you can recognize right off the bat, is look at how many things are embedded in the dermis. You have sweat glands. We'll talk about the different types of sweat glands. It's made of connective tissue, so it's vascularized, which means it's going to have blood vessels running through it. You also have nerve fibers, axons running through, receptors all through it. So there's a lot of structures located in the dermis, which is in contrast to the epidermis, which we remember is an epithelial tissue, which are avascularized, which means no blood vessels, just solid cells. Okay, so that's one important structure and one important difference to look at between the two. Okay, so also going into the dermis. The dermis has two layers. It has the papillary layer and it has the reticulary layer. Okay, so the papillary layer is this layer right here, which is going to be more superficial, and it's going to be directly underneath the epidermis, and it's going to contain loose areolar connective tissue, which is a connective tissue proper, which means it's going to basically glue on the epidermis from on top of that. So you do need to know the specific tissue type that makes up the papillary layer. You also need to understand why it's called the papillary layer. And if you look carefully, instead of just being like a flat layer, it creates these little mounds. Those little mounds are called dermal papillae. With papillae would be meaning plural, papilla would be singular. And papilla means mound, so that you're actually going to see this several times throughout the semester. So I suggest go ahead and add it to your root and prefix list. Make sure you understand when you see the word papilla or papilla or papillae, that is mound. So you're going to have some sort of mound structure. And those mound structures that are located in the papillary layer, that's why it's called the papillary layer, they are going to create your fingerprints. Right, so the ridges that you see on your fingers, they're also known as friction ridges. Those are actually derived from these little mounds, these dermal papillae that are located in the papillary layer of the dermis. And so that's what's going to create those little ridges. Okay, so that's the more superficial one. Underneath that is going to be the reticular layer, and the reticular layer is made up of dense, irregular connective tissue. And so we've already talked about this when we talked about tissues. Dense, irregular connective tissue. Remember that it's irregular because the collagen fibers, instead of running parallel to each other, which would be regular connective tissue, they are all in every which way, all choppy and oriented in multiple directions. And that's what creates the flexibility and the kind of strength in multiple different directions. So if you pull on your skin in all different directions, the collagen in the reticular layer, that's going to provide that kind of recoiling effect. And so as we age and we lose our collagen, that's what makes us droopy and that's how we get our wrinkles. Okay, so what you need to know the structure, dermal papillae. You need to understand how that relates to the papillary layer. And you need to know the specific tissue types that are found in each different layer. Okay, on to the hypodermis. Remember, hypo means below. So if epi is above, hypo is below. And the hypodermis has a lot of different connective tissues, and it has loose areolar connective tissue, but it also has, and this is the more distinctive one, it also has a lot of loose adipose connective tissue. And remember, anytime you hear the word adipose, you're now going to connect it in your mind to fat. So you got a lot of fat underneath your layer, underneath your dermis, in the hypodermis. And remember that the loose adipose connective tissue, it allows your skin to sort of store energy. It provides some cushioning to protect you against trauma. And it also is important for thermal regulation, which means just means helping you hold on to and insulate some of that heat. Okay, a little bit of pathology here. So let's look at burns, starting with sunburns. For sunburns, because of the damages that happen because of UV light penetrating into the skin, what can happen is your immune cells initiate inflammation. And inflammation just means swelling. And you can really especially see it in this picture here. So the swelling happens because the capillaries in the skin become leakier, so fluid, plasma from the blood is going to leak out into the tissues, and that's what causes the swelling. And so if it's bad enough, that's how you get this blistering effect. And the redness itself just comes from the increased circulation and inflammation in the skin. So you get sunburn because of your body's response to the UV light, not really the UV light itself. You see what I mean? And so let's also talk about burns. For burns, you have first, second, and third degree burns. And the designation comes from how deep the damage is going to be. So first degree burns would just be the epidermis. Second degree burns means it involves part of the dermis. And then third degree burns means the entire dermis is going to be damaged. And so the deeper you are, the harder it is to fix. And if you really think about this, this should make sense to you, because remember that the cells for regenerating the epidermis are in the stratum basale. And once the stratum basale is gone, you don't have those stem cells to regrow and regenerate the cells. So it makes it much more difficult. And so you're going to need a skin graft so that you can provide the stem cells to regrow and replenish the cells. Other than that, though, your skin does have pretty good regeneration properties, but if you get too deep or you're lacking the stem cells, then that's when the problem occurs, and that's when you require the skin grafts. Okay, that's all for this piece. We'll come back and talk about hair and nails.